Merry Christmas, but Happy New Year to everyone. We're glad that you're here with us by Facebook Live. And the reason why I am the only one here in the sanctuary is because I traveled out of town. And I am just going to assume that maybe I am asymptomatic with the coronavirus, and I didn't want to pass that on to anyone. So we will be meeting strictly on Facebook Live this Sunday and next Sunday until I get a negative test for COVID-19. But nevertheless, we are here and we can still celebrate who we are and what we are about in this world, whether we are all gathered in one place or not. So welcome and to this worship of God. The announcements are at the back of your bulletin, and because we are not meeting here in the sanctuary, there is no Sunday school, and we were supposed to start next week, but that is not going to happen. We will resume Sunday school, I believe, on the 24th of this month, and all things should be clear. We do have an annual meeting coming up, February the 7th, immediately after service, so please be mindful of your annual report coming to you, either in the mail or picking it up here at the church or even by email. I'm not quite sure if that's a possibility for some of you, but nevertheless, please call the church office and we'll let you know when you can, how you can receive that. And we also like to say happy birthday and happy anniversary to those who have birthdays in January and who are celebrating all kinds of wonderful things, anniversaries and good news this month. We rejoice with you and we pray God's blessings on you now and always. And with that, friends, let's join together in our call to worship. Hear these words from Holy Scripture. Just as the body is one and all and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews and Greeks, slave or free, and we are all made to drink of one Spirit. Now that we are the body of Christ and individually members of it, God has told you what is good. And what does the Lord require of us? To do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with God. Friends, our first hymn of the morning is Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, found on page 7 of our bulletin. Please be mindful that there are 3 verses to this hymn, and there is an introduction. I'll play it through for us. So be mindful of that.
Thank you.
servants of God every single day of our life, 24/7. But we are wise enough to know that often we fall short. And on this, the baptism of Sunday of the Lord, baptism of Jesus Sunday, we want to be mindful of who we are and whose control we are under, whose love we are always pursued by, even when we fall short of our promises. So friends, let's join in our confession of sin as a litany this morning. Sovereign God, in baptism you call us to turn from sin and to turn to Christ Jesus. But we stray from his ways and do not heed your call. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. In baptism you joined us to Christ in his death, that we might be raised with Christ in new life. But we cherish old ways and fail to embrace the risen life of righteousness, justice, and love. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. In baptism, you united us with all the baptized who confess your name, but we foster division in the church. We refuse to live as one people, and so fail to witness to your reconciling love before the world. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. In baptism, you call us to ministry in all realms of life, but we refuse the struggle to know your will. We do not nurture the ways of peace. We allow enmity and hatred to grow among us, putting neighbor against neighbor and nation against nation. We abuse the earth you would trust to our care and live in discord with all you have made. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. In baptism, you sent us to serve with compassion all for whom Christ died. But we ignore the suffering of the oppressed and the plight of the poor. We take bread from the hungry, and we do not listen for cries of justice. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. In baptism, you gave us the Holy Spirit to teach and guide us, but we rely on ourselves and refuse to trust your direction. We spurn your eternal wisdom, preferring the lurid ways of the world. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on us. Remember the promises you made to us in our baptism. Forgive our sinful ways and heal our brokenness. Set us free from all that enslaves us and raise us to new life in Jesus Christ, that we may be your faithful servants, showing forth your healing love to the world, to the glory of your holy name. Together, amen. And friends, please use these few seconds for your own silent prayer. Friends, hear the good news. We are loved with a steadfast love of God, long-suffering, patient, kind, always waiting to forgive, and always waiting to welcome us back. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are always already wanted and forgiven. Let us join now in the words of the Gloria. Glory to the Creator, the Christ, the Holy Spirit, three in one. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen. Would you bid the peace of Christ to the person sitting to your left or to your right or behind or in front of you as a sign of the friendship that we share in this household of God. The peace of Christ be with you. I just stand here. Maybe you can't see it. I'm over here. Lord Jesus to be born. And then he's born, and then the last two Sundays, he's a baby, and then he's a toddler, and now he's a grown man. And our service today has a lot to do with water. And in the Bible, the water has a lot of different meanings. Yes, it can clean things, it can wash things away, and it can also nurture people, our thirst when we get thirsty, and it can also help seeds to grow. But also, water in the Bible is about promises. Promises that God will never, ever leave us alone. And it's this common water that this Holy Spirit works through and reminds us that we are God's people. We are God's children. And no matter where we go, we can always be refreshed by God's Spirit. So for the rest of this service, and even after this service, think about water and how it is so precious. Maybe mom or dad tells you when you're running the faucet in the bathroom in the kitchen, turn that water off! Because we don't want to waste it. And we don't want to make it so dirty that nobody can use it. But with water, with the Spirit of God can help us to remember, yes, that we are baptized and that we are wanted. But the Spirit is always with us. Let's pray. Gracious God, thank you for every single thing that we have, from the clothes on our backs to the shoes on our feet to our homes to the water that we drink, that we forget about how precious it is. So help us to think about the other ways that water is helpful to us. Help us to remember that in all things you are with us still. In Christ's name we pray. Friends, be mindful that it takes a lot to keep this ministry going. Yes, my position here, but also all of the missions that continue to go forth, even under the pandemic, the COVID-19 virus that's going out and about and we're not meeting. We are still faithful and want to be faithful in our commitment. So if this church has blessed you in any way, please be mindful of it when you make your gifts of money, of time, of service, of whatever. Remember this church. And with that, having brought our gifts, let us offer up the doxology. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Praise God above the heavenly host, Creator, Christ, and Holy Ghost. Amen. And let us dedicate our offerings. Gracious God, accept these gifts and with them our lives to be used in your service through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Now is the time for prayer. I can't hear any in the sanctuary because there's no one here but me. But there are a number of things to be mindful of, to celebrate, yes, the passing into another year, full of all kinds of possibility and promise. The friends that we have, the gifts that we received during the holidays, the gifts that we were able to give and even be for people around us. Being joyful for people who have made it back home, back to school, safely. And all of the transitions that will come, ones that we know about and plan that we want to happen, and also ones that we know that will come and surprise us. Let's also be mindful of people who are ill, who are dealing with not so good news, and also for the transitions and the troubles in our own nation. And if there are no others, let's pray. also sit and weep and mourn and hope and pray and wait with those who are contending with illness or any kind of disease or displacement, those who are sad for some reason that not even they can put their finger on it. We pray for those making transitions from one job to another, one state to another, relationship transitions, health transitions, and all the like. We pray for your mercy and for your guidance. We pray for helping hands to be with all of us and those who we don't know who are facing challenges at this moment. Those in health crises, those whose lives are endangered because of violence or war or disease. God, we ask that your peace and your justice and your safety would surround all of us. And if there is any injury or harm, we pray that folk of good conscience and goodwill and good faith will rush in and save and protect. Gracious God, our nation is rocked right now. But even as we think of things to do, our leaders, that is, we ask that you overrule in situations where there is harm and violence and the threat of violence. God, it seems so puny to ask for understanding and peace with accountability, but we do it anyway, because those are the ways in which you work, and those are the ways in which true understanding and true correction and true reconciliation can happen, not by force, not by violence. So God, help our nation and our leadership. Lead us through this. Help us all to reach for a brighter day with substantive understanding and justice, where everyone can find their space and be heard, where fear no longer rules, where hate is not turned into a good thing. Gracious God, these and other things we would pray for all day, all week, all month long. So God, you know, you see us, you walk with us. So guide our feet while we run this race, because God, we do not want to run this race in vain. So hold us in the palm of your hand and keep us safe as you keep all people safe. And when we, our attention and our energy would flag, we pray that you would give us enough strength to pray the prayer that your Son taught us to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The gospel lesson this morning is from the book of Mark, chapter 1, verses 4 through 11. Listen for God's word to us in this scripture. John the Baptist was in the wilderness, calling for people to be baptized, to show that they were changing their hearts and lives and wanted God to forgive their sins. Everyone in Judea and all the people of Jerusalem went out to the Jordan River and were being baptized by John as they confessed their sin. John wore clothes made of camel's hair and with a leather belt around his waist. He ate locusts and wild honey. He announced, "One stronger than I is coming after me. I am not even worthy to bend over and loosen the strap of his sandals. I baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." About that time, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee, and John baptized him in the Jordan. And while Jesus was coming up out of the water, Jesus saw heaven splitting open, and the Spirit, like a dove, coming down in him. And there was a voice from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I dearly love. In you I find happiness." In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. I acknowledge just a minute ago that it may have been weird to see a Protestant minister cross herself in a UCC pulpit. It's not something that I grew up with. In fact, I was told to stay away from people like that because they were superstitious. Nevertheless, crossing myself is something that has come to me late in my own formation and identity as a particular kind of Christian. This is a gesture of form of prayer. It's a body prayer, if you please, traced back as far as the 3rd century of this common era. It has finally rested in my heart and become a part of my daily life for the last 2.5 years. Yes, people have crossed themselves for all kinds of reasons. That their favorite sports team will win, or that bad news will turn into good news. I'm not here to judge, for I know what prayer has meant to me in my personal life and in my work as a parish minister. My rationale for making the sign of the cross is grounded in baptism, my baptism into God's love and acceptance of me long before the beginning of time, and my baptism as a girl of 12 years old, and even the main part of the body of Christ that includes believers from every time and place. That is why I cross myself. That is why it is so linked to baptism for me. Little did I know it at the time, but baptism was the beginning of everything for me. I'm baptized, therefore I pray. I pray in order to remember my baptism, for it is in my baptism that I realize who I am and what kind of life I am called to live. And if your life is anything like mine, you need to be reminded, because I am forgetful and I am sometimes utterly unreliable. So making the sign of the cross serves as a prompt for me to live into those two realities through the power of the Spirit. The gospel lesson that we heard a few minutes ago throws all of this into sharp relief, not so much making the sign of the cross, but the living of a cruciform life in light of our baptism. Very little is known about Jesus' life from the time that he was presented at the temple as a young boy until the time he is initiated and starts a new renewal movement in the Jewish community of his day. Unlike Matthew and Luke, who include a birth narrative in their writing, Mark plunges headlong and he starts with Jesus as an adult. For Mark, the first high water mark in Jesus' life is not his birth, but his baptism. As his parents had him undergo the ritual ceremony of circumcision, followed by a coming of age ceremony at about 12 years old, here Jesus presents himself, he does it himself, to be baptized by John the prophet. Without discussion, without fanfare, Jesus arrives at the Jordan River. We can only assume that he was listening to the priests. He had long been listening to the priests, learning the faith and the rituals of his people. And we can also assume that he was listening and watching the Roman government as well as the temple authorities as they often contravened their own laws while governing the people. Yet, we can be sure that Jesus was mindful that some things were out of alignment, living in a world of faith and a world of the government. Even as the people of his day were called, like their ancestors, to live in true fidelity to God while seeking the welfare of the city in which they lived, somehow lines of faithfulness became blurred, confused, and his fellow sisters and brothers began to abuse each other and to take their cues from about right relationships and justice from groups where those two things were not even in the mix. I interpret Jesus' baptism as the response of a person who had become alive to God as a result of John's preaching. He had, over time, come to a clear awareness of the inbreaking of God in his own life, in his own time, amongst his own people, in light of their lived experience of dislocation and fragmentation. Jesus came to the Jordan River to be numbered among the people who heard and responded positively to John's preaching of the coming of, yes, the kingdom of God, but more crucially, the realm of God in their life and how it overflows into all the other lives and paths of people whom they cross. This was a signaling of a new beginning for life in Jesus. A decisive step, a cut off from his 30 years prior to that moment, and the beginning of another one with deep, deep intentionality. And that intentionality, that life, that giving, that death would impact Judea and Jerusalem all the way up to us in this moment. And the first step of that new awareness of who he was and what he was called to do began with his baptism. Jesus, like John and all the others, outed themselves as they stood there publicly, people looking on. They outed themselves as going against the grain, going against the status quo. No longer would they acquiesce to the temple and the Roman authorities, living quiet and obedient lives. In baptism, they were sharpening the focus of their faith and life, citizens of God's reign, while living and serving, striving for faithfulness, justice, reconciliation, and equity in a society seemingly allergic to it and hell-bent on destroying any awareness of it. By being baptized, Jesus was opting for a deeper, riskier, more accountable participation in this renewal movement a movement that contested the all-consuming, invasive, manipulative power of religious and governmental authorities that would keep people bound and beholden to their powers, their will, particularly when it was in contravention of God's love and God's reign of justice. Friends, this is the baptism, the movement, the life that you and I have been called into, been initiated into, a movement of renewal, recovery, inclusion, an open table, and open hearts. This is the reason why we gather on Sunday mornings and at any other time or place as the Church of Jesus Christ. We are here to declare that there is another way of being alive, another way of addressing grievances and difference, another way of attending to abuse and loss and fear. Our baptism indicates that there is a path that leads from our comfortable, narrow confines of our likes and personal dislikes to a wider, higher ground where love of the other is not only possible, but it's preferable. This is the meaning of Jesus' baptism. This is the meaning of baptism, our baptism, into his life. It's not an easy reality to wrap our hearts around. Neither is it any easy path to follow. That's why we need reminders. You have to find your own way, whether it's making the sign of the cross, or singing a song, or some other kind of body prayer. You have to find what helps you remember and live into your baptismal vows every single day and pursue it. Presenting ourselves or our children for baptism is an awesome and monumental occasion. The spoken word, the splash of water. I think I've cried at every baptism that I've had the privilege of officiating at. Yet baptism is only the beginning. Remember, there are promises made. Promises to teach and nurture, as well as be taught and nurtured. Promises to renounce those things that we do and say in order that separate us from ourselves and from God. Promises to turn again and strive to be faithful disciples of Jesus. We need something to help us remember who we are and what we're about, particularly in these days of national crises, heightened suspicion, name-calling, hubris, and overt acts of hatred and bigotry and harm. Regardless, in light of our gender expression, class, race, political sensitivities, whatever label you want to slap on there, we must remember that we, in this congregation, this Christian congregation, and congregations around the world, that we have been baptized. And that's no small potatoes, friends. It's not just a ceremonial religious ritual. It's the fundamental substance of who we are. We are water washed, spirit born people of God, called to make a difference, a deep, deep difference in a world uproar with hostilities and bent on self-destruction sometimes. Mind you, we're not perfect. None of us are perfect. We are just as confused and messed up and jaded and shady as people who are not religious or of another religious persuasion or none at all. Even so, God has promised to use us and to help us point one another to how God is working, how God can use us. And over the years, I've come to know that God doesn't turn away from any of us, even in our fits and starts and unbelief and sometimes belief and sometimes not sure enough of that we are Christians and that we can really do this, that we can really be a witness to a new realm. Our baptism calls us to live a cruciform life. As we live our lives in gratitude to God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, we also live among people who love God, love fiercely, and calls us to serve fiercely. The cruciform life begs, frees, empowers us to serve God and others as a seeker, as a steward, as a sower, as a shepherd of love. As we move within our individual spheres of influence, may we seek the kingdom of God and God's righteousness. May we be good stewards of this world's resources and the particular gifts that God has given to each one of us. May we sow good seed on every path that we trace, even those paths that we think are unfertile and can bear nothing. Help us to be faithful, even when it's uncomfortable and unpopular. Help us to stand and witness. May we shepherd and care for all, for those beautiful souls who God places in our path, if ever so briefly. Even those that we think are not beautiful. Because we all have in our heads, there are some people who are unbeautiful, unloving, unlovable, and not worth our time. But such is not the case in the kingdom of God, among the people of God. All are welcome, all are wanted, all are pursued by God, and we should pursue them too. Friends, this is the essence of our baptism. We go against the grain. We go against the prevailing notions of right and wrong to tease out a space where all are heard and where love and compassion and reconciliation can happen as hard and long as it is. This is the meaning of our baptism. This is a life into which we have all been called. And as we walk into it, may we one day hear, in our own way and in our own time, "You are my child, my beloved. With you I am well pleased. In you I find great happiness." Amen. Friends, on page 4, 5, and 6 of your bulletin, you will find a program for the reaffirmation of baptismal vows. Friends, this is not a rebaptism. It is just a reminder that we are called again to know who we are, what we are about in this world. So friends, as you find it in your bulletin, let's join together in reaffirming our baptismal vows. words of scripture. Lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bonds of peace. Sisters and brothers in Christ, our baptism is a sign and seal of our cleansing from sin and our being grafted into Christ. Through the birth, life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, the power of sin was broken, and God's kingdom entered our world. Through our baptism, we are made citizens of God's kingdom and freed from the bondage of sin. Let us celebrate that freedom and redemption through the renewal of promises made in our baptism. I ask you, therefore, once again, to reject sin, to profess your faith in Jesus Christ, and to confess the faith of the church, the faith in which you were baptized. These are the renunciations. Friends, do you renounce all evil and powers in the world which defy God's righteousness and love? I renounce them. Do you renounce the ways of sin that separate you from the love of God? I renounce them. Do you turn to Jesus Christ and acknowledge him anew as your Lord and Savior? I do. Will you be Christ's faithful disciple, obeying God's word and showing God's love to all your life's end? I will, with God's help. Friends, let us confess our faith using the Apostles' Creed. With the whole church, do you believe in God the Father? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again, and he ascended to heaven. He is seated at the right hand of God the Father. And from there he will come to judge the quick and the dead. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us continue. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give the Lord our thanks and praise. Let us pray. Eternal and gracious God, we give you thanks. In countless ways you have revealed yourself in ages past and have blessed us with the signs of your grace. We praise you that through the waters of the sea you led your people Israel out of bondage into freedom in the land of your promise. We praise you for sending Jesus, your Son, who for us was baptized in the waters of the Jordan and was anointed by Christ as the Christ by your Holy Spirit. Through the baptism of his death and resurrection, you set us free from the bondage of sin and death and gave us cleansing and rebirth. We praise you for your Holy Spirit, who teaches us and leads us into all truth, filling us with a variety of gifts that we might proclaim the gospel to all nations and serve you as a royal priesthood. We rejoice that you claimed us in our baptism and that by your grace we are born anew. By your Holy Spirit, renew us
that we may be empowered to do your will and continue forever in the risen life of Christ, to whom, with you and the Holy Spirit, be all glory and honor, now and forever. Together, amen. Let us remember our baptism and be thankful. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Together, amen. Friends, our final hymn is called As Partners in God's Service, found on page 8 of your bulletin. Let's sing together. And remember, it has an introduction.
Blessings of God Almighty, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer,
be and remain with all of us until we meet again. And the people of God said, Amen. Go in peace.